First of all, they matter because the European Parliament is the only directly elected institution of the European Union. In that sense, it reflects one of the two sources of legitimacy of the European Union, namely individual citizens. The other source of legitimacy of the European Union is the member states, whose wishes are reflected primarily in the Council of Ministers, where ministers who are members of national governments meet and co-legislate alongside the European Parliament. The second reason why European elections matter is that the Parliament has obtained a lot of legislative powers and other powers, especially since the mid-1990s. In particular, it has become a proper co-legislator of the European Union alongside the Council of Ministers. And that practically means that most of the legislative decisions that are made reflect the wishes of the single largest political group inside the European Parliament, that is elected every 5 years directly by individual citizens. The third reason why European elections matter is that since 2014, reflecting a decision made by the member states that reformed the treaties in Lisbon in 2009, the outcome of European elections reflect directly, in the selection of the key office holder that is the President of the European Commission. In simpler terms, the outcome of these elections dictates to a very large extent which political family will get the first chance to form a coalition inside the European Parliament and thus support an explicitly political president of the European Commission. The European Commission is the main executive body of the European Union. Back in 2014, that was the first time when this new system was actually put into practice. What happened at that point in time is that each of the five largest political groups of the European Parliament chose one lead candidate several months before the election. So when ordinary citizens went to the polls in May 2014, they knew not only the kind of program that each political group supported, but also who was the likely president of the European Commission for the next 5 years, provided, of course, that candidate could muster, could organize, could put together a coalition with a majority inside the European Parliament. One important development that took place in 2014 on top of that was that the five candidates that represented or that had the support of the five largest political groups inside the European Parliament made a political decision before the elections, and they said one of us will have to be the president of the European Commission, even if national governments that have a say don't want one of us to do that. That was a political commitment, democratic political commitment, made before the election, so ordinary citizens were supposed to know more concretely what the consequences of their vote would be. The systemic implication of this particular commitment was that the EU took a massive step towards its further democratization, in particular its parliamentarization. It's a system basically that begins to resemble increasingly to national parliamentary political systems. Now, that is a decision that the member states, the governments of the member states, or some member states, including the UK, did not really like, because they are accustomed to striking backroom deals away from the eye of ordinary citizens in an effort to promote what they see as the appropriate form of political decision-making within the European Union. The first opportunity they have to do something about this is next week. Once the election results are known, chances are that several leaders of the member states, including President Macron of France, but also Angela Merkel, the Chancellor of Germany, will do whatever they can, for different reasons, to choose the President of the European Commission without necessarily choosing one of the five candidates that have been chosen by the largest political groups within the European Parliament. Obviously, if that happens, it seems very likely it will be a step back, not a step forward, for the European Union. But it is also an expression of the intergovernmental drift that has been characterizing the process of integration, and in particular the operation of the European Union, for maybe 1 to 2 decades. President Macron is likely to do that to a large extent because he embodies long-held French views about these things, but also because being the creator of a new political party that has no equivalent or no political family of its own inside the European Parliament, he wants to change the system. And the excuse he's using is that since there are no transnational political lists of candidates for membership of the European Parliament, why should we have the system that in German is known as Spitzenkandidaten or top candidates? You cannot have one without the other. The final reason why these European elections are likely to be very important is that Europe's enemies, the enemies of the idea of European integration, are no longer knocking on the EU's doors. They are likely to be inside the European Parliament, vociferous as always, but not necessarily effective. The idea here is that they are beginning to change strategy, and instead of opposing Europe from outside, they will do whatever they can to subvert the system from the inside. Some of them are already saying so openly. The question is, will ordinary citizens allow them to do so? As for Brexit, one striking thing is that throughout this campaign, Brexit as an issue has not attracted attention in the other 27 member states, certainly no positive attention. And this is not surprising. The popularity of the European Union across the board has increased in the other 27 member states. And the image that the British political elite is giving, not only within Westminster but also beyond, is one that justifies to a very large extent the fact that Brexit as an issue has not attracted almost any attention in other member states in the run-up to this year's European elections. Frankly, who can blame them?